Welcome to the Sal and Rich Show. Today we honor all the men and women who have served and are serving in the United States. Air Force, Navy, Army, Marines, and Coast Guard. We thank you for your service. Today we are honored to have United States Air Force veteran Stan Bilecki. Take it away, Sal, and Stan, thank you for your service.
Here we go. We finally got it to work. Yesterday we had, a couple days ago, we did an interview with Gabrielle McCluskey. It went perfectly. And today, of course, nothing goes perfectly 2 days in a row. Right, Rich?
It's Murphy's Law.
It sure is.
Or Riverside Law.
Riverside Law. Welcome, Stan Bilecki.
Yes.
Thank you for being here.
Happy to be here.
Happy to have you.
Absolutely.
One opening for me would be, Sal, you and I remember you from high school. They were great memories. His sense of humor hasn't changed a bit. We were in the band together. And Rich, I don't remember you, but he did marry someone that I, you know, I was kind of close with. You know, Jan was in the orchestra too.
Yes.
And we both played string bass. And she remembers me because I was always there to tune hers, to tune the string bass that she could.
Oh, the bass. Okay.
I knew he was going there.
As she left for Mahjong today, I think I pissed her off. She said, I should have married Stan. And that was the end of it.
No way.
Man. You've been living in California today.
That's right. You know, Stan, it's so funny you mentioned the band. I could not remember what you were playing. I thought you played a horn instrument, but I guess I was wrong. You played bass.
I think when I signed up, I followed my cousin who was playing string bass. So I was a year behind him. I ended up doing string bass too. So I ended up playing bass guitar and things like that. But in the marching band, we didn't carry the string bass.
Right.
So I ended up with a baritone horn.
Oh, okay.
Smaller
so that's
than
what I remember.
Tuba, but it,
yeah. Yeah. And I had to carry the sousaphone. So
you played this
sousaphone. Yeah. With Tommy Quayle. And Tommy and I played in grade school at Our Lady of Grace.
Are you two going to play today or what?
No.
Gabrielle sang.
Yeah, I know. She did sing. I should have, I haven't picked up a sousaphone in like 55 years. So there's no way I'm going to play. But you're still playing bass guitar? That's cool.
Well, I'm guitar. I'm playing guitar now and then, but not regularly. Like Tommy Quayle does.
Oh, yeah. Those guys are in a different league. So you have a little doggy there, your puppy.
Is that safe
Oliver.
To assume? Is that Oliver?
That's Oliver.
This is Oliver. He's a year old, and he is a veteran, but I invited him anyway.
He's adorable.
Trying to keep him.
That's great.
He is never on. I do video things, and he never gets on my lap for that. But today, he wants to say hi.
You wanted to be in the Sal and Rich show. Okay. Everybody wants to be on the show, right, Rich?
Everybody wants to be here. Yes. We're just lining people up left and right.
That's right. Yeah. So anyway, thank you for taking the time, Stan. We really appreciate this. You and I chatted a couple days ago and talked a little bit about your career, and it turns out that my career in IT and Stan's kind of were in parallel universes. We both were in the classified world, and it's about all we can say. But it was interesting to see your path. And then you wound up, after leaving the Air Force, you wound up working for a small company that I knew very well in Reston Park. In Reston, they were on the parkway there. It's called Scitor. So why don't you start by telling us a little bit about how you got into the Air Force and, you know, the whole that led you to make those decisions.
Okay. I'll be as succinct as I can here. So as I think back, the 60s, you know, that was the thing that got me excited in life was keeping up with the Apollo missions from NASA, the manned space flight program. Mercury, you know, John Glenn flew on my sister's birthday. I can remember that. Gemini was an exciting set of missions. And then Apollo walking on the moon, that was pretty great. And that happened while we were in high school.
Right.
And so I was attracted to the space program, and I don't know about being an astronaut so much, maybe, but I really wanted to be a pilot. So when I was in high school, I can remember in my junior year, we had an aeronautics class. There was it was unusual, I think.
Yeah.
There was like 5 or 7 guys that signed up for it. There's a picture of they call it the Aeronautics Club, I think. But there was a class. There was a woman pilot that taught it. She took us for rides on the light aircraft, and it got me excited. I had friends that had fathers that were pilots and stuff, so I thought I was going to do that.
Right.
And then there was the draft occurred. So there were 3 drafts that I was watching, 1970, 71, and 72. So my birthday is actually coming up here, the 25th of November. That date, in the first draft, it showed up as number 23.
Oh, boy.
So it's like, well, that's kind of, it wouldn't affect me because it's my year. But right. I said, okay, well, what are the chances of my birthday showing up low? And the next year, my birthday showed up as 97.
Oh, boy.
Still a acceptable number, So I was kind of making some plans. I knew I wanted to go to college. I applied for the Air Force Academy. I thought that was going to be a possible direction, and looked into some other things. And then the next draft was, and I ended up not going to the academy. I went to St. Joe's College, now it's St. Joseph's University. I went through an Air Force ROTC program. The draft that affected our class.
Right.
Birthday came out as number 25.
Mm.
So I was always a threat, I think, for getting, and that probably was motivation. I think about when I go places and people will ask, hey, who's a veteran in the group? And, I'll raise my hand or stand up. And it's like 5% of the crowd were veterans. And that I always thought that was curious, Mm-hmm. But I look back and the draft driving, that draft really did force me to go in a direction. So I decided to go in the military. Air Force ROTC, it was, exciting stuff. I learned how to fly when I was in college, and I had military physicals, and they'd check me out and say, hey, you're passing, you're as healthy as a pilot needs to be. My eyes were good. I was physically good, and I was tall. So I was 6'6". And when I went to get a physical, they'd see me walking in and they go, okay, we're going to measure you. But we're gonna put. They set the maximum was 6'4", and they set the level of the ruler, and they said, okay, get up, get in there, and stand up underneath of that. So I kind of squatted in order to be a couple inches shorter, and they wrote me down as 6'4", and my sitting height was acceptable for small aircraft. So I was good. I graduated from college in '75. I expected to get a pilot. Orders that's going to go to pilot training. Well, it didn't happen. The Vietnam War was, I think it officially was over, but we were still pulling troops out. And
right.
I ended up not getting a pilot slot to start with. It was actually over a year later that I got my orders, and I actually went on active duty in July of 1976. So I had a year of hanging around.
Where were you stationed at that point? You were at home?
Well, I was living at home. I lived at home and commuted to Philadelphia.
Okay.
And the job that carried me through the end of college was I worked in a record shop. I worked in Keller's House of Music. And the coincidence there is that it was in the shopping center that was over the hill from Paul the Sixth. So I thought that was a fun coincidence. And see
Westmont Shopping Center.
Yeah.
So I went on. I had to pick another career field because I wasn't going to get a pilot job. So I looked at the list and chose space systems because it sounded almost like that's what I want to do. Well, right. The order sent to Colorado Springs, and Colorado Springs is a military town. There's an Air Force Academy there. I wasn't going there. There was a base, and then there's a NORAD, and that's the headquarters of where you know, the defense for the United States, but also for North America completely. It would be defense for Canada as well. And
ballistic missiles, right?
We there was a ballistic missile job, a missile warning job, and then there's a satellite tracking job. Now, everybody should have heard of, you know, NORAD, Christmas Eve, NORAD tracks Santa Claus.
Right.
And that tracking is what I was assigned to. So I was going to learn how to track all the satellites, the 10,000 pieces that we would keep track of. Crazy. Yeah. And it was an accounting job. So I ended up doing that for a couple years. And then they sent me to one of the remote sites because it was time to, I got to finish. So Colorado Springs, 2 years, my first time away from home. I move out there. I do get an apartment. I get myself comfortable with living, you know, being a bachelor in Colorado Springs. I get assigned to a job and I meet this young lady. So I met my wife in Colorado Springs. She was actually an Indiana girl, but it just was a magical time for us. And so in the first 2 years, we got married. We bought a house. I had a boy, had a son. And then I get sent on a remote tour. My wife said, I didn't sign up for that, because she stayed in Colorado with a child and a house. And I went to Thule, Greenland, which you may have heard about.
Yeah.
It was Thule Air Force Base and renamed. It's Space Force Base, and it's got a new name that I can't remember or I can't pronounce. But I spent a year up there. And the job that they were planning to bring me back to was going to be space accounting, you know, just tracking and counting satellites and, you know, figuring out orbits.
Did your wife go up to Greenland?
It's a remote tour, and it's unaccompanied. So I lived in a barracks with a bunch of, you know, some married and single guys. And, you know, we went off to the radar site each day to work, you know, work on console and look for the missiles. Right. You know, and that was a big, I worked at a BMUS site, ballistic missile early warning.
Right.
But that really wasn't a fun job. It was important, but not fun. But what's also up on at Thule was a satellite command and control station that they sent commands and satellites, and they were doing important stuff. So I made, you know, I'm in the O Club after having a few beers, and somebody came up to me and said, "Hey, have you heard about this?" And they told me about Sunnyvale, California, and that's where a lot of the defense satellites, you know, were controlled from when they got their start. So the satellite control facility located very close to Moffett Naval Air Station, which is in Mountain View, California, Northern California, the southern tip of the San Francisco Bay. Right. So we lived in San Jose, and I have two sons in San Jose. I served 5 years. My final 5 years in the Air Force were there at this satellite control facility. The fun part of that job was I worked my way into the control team that was going to support the space shuttle, which was a new launch system. You know, NASA flew Apollo.
Yeah.
The last flight was 1975. How are we going to fly? Well, they were developing a space shuttle. It didn't fly until 1981, but I worked in it with a team, and our job was to provide Air Force ground system support to the space shuttle missions.
And that had to be fun.
So it was kind of exciting.
Yeah, that had to be a blast. Well,
that was fun. The fun part was the space shuttle was a launch system. So satellites were designed and built to fit inside the bay of the space shuttle. And when it was a DOD or an Air Force mission, My team was used to interface with the NASA flight controllers to do the mission. We didn't talk to the astronauts, but we would talk to the team and relay something to the PACOM or to the CAPCOM, and then he would tell the crew to do something, and they were controlling the satellites that we were worried about. It was exciting.
Yeah.
I did that for 5 years. I decided 8 years was enough. I didn't want to go remote again. I didn't want to. We liked the North Bay. We liked San Jose. And I ended up leaving the Air Force, joining a team that worked at Scitor Corporation. And I spent 30 years touching all kinds of satellite programs. And it was a lot of fun. And if it wasn't for my military time, I wouldn't have discovered that company, and I wouldn't have gotten involved in a lot of other exciting stuff.
So how many years did you do in the military?
I was an 8-year veteran.
8-year veteran, okay.
2 years in Colorado, 1 year in Greenland, 5 years in the South Bay.
And did you have to go through like a typical boot camp when you joined?
Well, I went through Air Force ROTC, and what they had, they sent me to a 6-week summer camp. I think it was the summer after my freshman year in college.
Okay.
I went to Columbus, Ohio.
All right.
And I think that's the first time I flew in an airliner, was to fly to Ohio to spend 6 weeks. And it was a bunch of guys that were ROTC, you know, they were in college, and the plan was to come out of that as a second lieutenant. And, it was, I can remember waking up at 6 a.m. and going, you know, making your bed, running outside, you know, the reveille was playing, you know,
the drill,
you know, you wake up to the morning sound, still running a couple miles, had to eat quick and get ready for some training and classes, but it was interesting and fun. But so 6 weeks of that, not too bad.
Yeah, that's not bad. You were fortunate that, you didn't, you know, like typical, you know, you go out for 3 months, I think, is what I remember. Army, you know, you do that. You talked about Scitor and your 30 years there, which is amazing. Because today, as we all know, not many people are with one company that long. It's a different environment from when our parents went to work. I was lucky I had 20 years at TRW and then went off and did a bunch of other different things. One thing I want to get to about your experience in being in the Air Force, I like to ask vets, what is it that you took from that experience that helped you at Scitor or for the rest of your life? What disciplines came out of that experience?
Well, you have to learn how to communicate pretty succinctly. You have to respect the chain of command. But you need to be able to solve problems. Hmm. So I think a big part of the team that I worked with at Scitor, we had a lot of ex-military. So we understood, you know, an Air Force officer in a position probably will be there for 2 to 4 years. And you have to develop a relationship, not just with your government customer, but with the, you know, the other companies that are there. So you have to be a team builder. So I'd say a lot of those things came out of my Air Force experience.
What was your rank when you left?
I left as a captain. So I was an 03. That's just by keeping your nose clean and doing your job. So I will say, you know, we were close to a Navy base in Sunnyvale, and we'd go in there and, you know, Captain Bilecki, okay, you go to the front of the line, because a Navy captain is an 06. They're like a colonel. It's funny. People that were confused about that kind of stuff. I must have looked older too. So.
What would you say to someone, a young person that's thinking about going into the military today? What advice would you give that person?
Well, I do believe that the military is a great start for many people, most people. It just introduces you to a lot of responsibility and information. You know, you learn about your country, Right. You learn about the defense world. You understand how we fit in the world. I think that's a huge thing. And if, you know, most people that were my age, you know, even coming out of college, you know, you pick a major, that doesn't mean you know what you want to do. And the Air Force will give you, you know, they'll give you a job and you're going to find out what you like or don't like.
All right.
And I think that's a great start for people.
So to your credit, I mean, you went into the service, what, 1975, you said?
Well, 76 was my start of active duty.
I mean, a lot of people our age didn't even want to think about the service.
Yeah.
Back then. I give you credit.
Well, we talked about the draft.
Yeah.
And I've thought about why, you know, why me? Why am I standing up at a party and most people aren't, because they aren't veterans. It's just, you know, the luck of the draw and kind of the interest I had. You know, I think if I didn't have a low draft number, maybe I would have gone in the NASA civilian space direction, you know?
Yeah.
But the military direction was it couldn't have worked out better in my life.
When you think about the 8 years from the time we went to Paul Six till you graduated college, those were tumultuous years. You think about the late 60s, the assassinations, the Vietnam War, the Tet Offensive. I mean, these are the historical moments that you're trying to make decisions. And we all went through this. I was fortunate, and so was Rich, that my draft number was like 350. And so it was never a possibility that I would be drafted. But I do remember sitting around the table with my parents, who were really worried about what my number was going to be, and having some serious discussions about, well, you know, how would you respond and what would you do if your number was low and all of that. And it stuck with me that I was so fortunate, because I had a friend of mine who I went to grade school with and wound up going to Sterling, and his number was 2. So he was gone immediately in a few weeks. And I remember him going, I think he went into the Army, and he kind of said he picked his military group that he wanted to be a part of. But I'll never forget that period. And, you know, in history is an important thing for us to not forget. And when you put it in that context, there was a lot going on into your decision. So it sounds like obviously you made the right decision, because it was a great experience.
Yeah, I got a story, quick story here.
Yeah.
So I was living in Lindenwall, New Jersey. I went to St. Lawrence School.
Okay.
And I lived right on a lake, you know, across the street from the lake, a house my dad built. He had a plumbing and heating business. And I would help him in some summers, but I did not. That was not my goal in a career. But we talked about, you know, I'm going to put Bilecki and Son, plumbing and heating. It's like, don't know putting that on the truck yet, you know. But my parents supported me in town. But I graduated in May of 75. I'm waiting for orders to come to send me to pilot training. When I finally do get orders, it's April of 76. So I'm sitting in the back stoop of our house, where we use the back door as our main entrance. And there was a relatively new house next to us. And my mom is sitting there with me, an envelope from the Air Force. I open it up. It's got my report date. You know, you're going to Colorado, you know, in July. And so we're talking about that. And then we look over to the house next to us, and there's a young couple looking at the house, and they're interested in buying it. Well, they do buy it. And it turns out it was Tom Quayle and his wife.
No.
So Tom is a classmate of ours.
Yes. Yeah.
He still lives in the house next to where I grew up.
Yep.
He raised three kids, and I could only imagine, you know, I was away. I raised my family away from home, and my parents didn't see their grandkids a lot. We didn't have video telecons.
Right.
So I imagine that they'd look over and see the kids running around. They just imagine, you know, their young grandkids are running around like that.
Oh, that's a great story. So, I went to grade school with Tommy. So I've known Tommy since the third grade. And they're still in that house. You're right, because I send them Christmas cards every year. That's super. Such a small world. You know?
So did your parents get to see the grandchildren often?
They would come out once a year, and we'd get back every other year. We'd travel back to New Jersey, and they saw them, but it's not like living 30 minutes away. You know, it'd be a phone call, but it was difficult.
And you know, my father was born and raised in Seattle. I never met my grandfather till I was 12, 13 years old. And it was like walking up to a brick wall. There was no emotion whatsoever. Mm. It was just kind of strange because he was in the service during World War II. And so for some reason, he wound up in Philadelphia, I guess because of my mother. But I never met him. I met my grandfather once or twice in my life.
Yeah. And I had the exact opposite experience. I grew up with my grandparents. I'm sorry, Stan. Go ahead.
And that's fact. So I had one. I can remember my grandfather. I took his name for my confirmation name. I remember that. And I remember telling him that. And I think he was on his deathbed when that happened. Mm. So when is that? How old are we when we?
10, 12.
Yeah, 10 or 12.
So I remember my grandparents and my parents. My parents have been gone since 2001. So I was in my 40s when I lost my parents, and they knew they were young kids, but they weren't going to be great grandparents.
Yeah,
they wouldn't see that. Hmm. But I now live. I have one grandchild, and she's a little girl, 3 and a half, and she lives about 20 miles from us. So that's
great. That's nice.
It's great.
That's great. Speaking of classmates,
occasionally, right?
Get them.
Speaking of classmates, you have a couple of guys out there that are nearby. You got Phil Militello, right? He lives in California. I'm forgetting who the other person is. There's a couple of guys out there. Bob DeLisa. Yeah.
Bob DeLisa. So in 1975, I think Bob went to Rutgers, and 1975, he took a job in San Francisco. So he was in San Francisco the longest.
Okay.
I came in 1979. I came to San Jose. So I was a few years behind. And then Phil Militello, he and his wife met when they went to college in Goshen. Oh, no, no. Actually, I forget what college he went to. But he was, they met in college, and they lived in California, and they moved back east a couple of times, and they lived in a number of different places, but they ended up coming back to California and settling in Napa. Oh, so nice. They live in Napa. I live in Walnut Creek, and Bob lives in Livermore. And if you look on a map, you draw a line, and I bisect the line between Napa and it's that. We see each other. We just saw each other last weekend.
That's great. That's great. The West Coast contingent. We ever have another reunion, you guys got to fly out.
Well, I'll tell you, if we keep talking like this and keep being close to each other, and I keep getting birthday notices about classmates. Yeah.
Sorry.
I'm excited. I'd love to come back. So we'll see. So what is it, 3 years away?
About 2 years.
Yeah. We talked 55.
We graduated in 71. So that's 2-3 years. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll see if we can round up.
Bob DeLisa really wants to come back. And he raised his family in San Francisco, three kids, all three relocated to the East Coast for college and have stayed on. So his kids are all East Coast. So he goes back a lot. And I think he could fit the reunion in easily. It would be a little more of a challenge for me, but I'd love to come back for it.
Well, we will keep you in. Hope you obviously, you'll be on the invite list.
We're trying to get those numbers up.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. That's great. I think we'll wrap it up. We try to
keep this participated. They participated in the reunion, right?
Yes, they
did. You sent your photograph in.
Yep.
Baseball. You're at the Giants game.
Yeah. So that was the first one in the photo album, I think, because it was the day before.
Yes.
Yeah. That was great. So you're not an Eagles fan, Stan?
Oh, you want to talk about that? So I've been in California for 4 years. Well, when I went in the Air Force, I went to Colorado. Here's the part.
Right.
I was an Eagles and Phillies fan, and they couldn't do shit until I left home. And so I'm in Colorado, and I there's no USA Today. There's no internet, per se. Right. There's no ESPN. There's no way to keep up with the games, you know? So right. It was easy to fade away from it. And then I came to California, and I came to a sports mecca. You know, the 49ers had just hired Bill Walsh.
Yeah.
The San Francisco 49ers won me over. The San Francisco Giants, historic. I can remember listening to Phillies games. You know, the games against San Francisco, they'd start at 10:30 at night. So I'd listen on the radio, and I'd hear half the game, and I'd wake up, and I'd miss the end, you know, and I'd have to wake up and catch the news to find out if they won. And, of course, the newspaper would not have the results
right.
on a late-night yeah. game. So anyway, yeah. so I'm a West Coast fan, and there's so many colleges and great sports programs. It was easy to convert. So now when I on my apps, I track the Niners initially, and then I do track the Eagles for their success.
Yeah, the Eagles and the Phillies have really come alive.
It's great. It's great to see that. So I'm excited. I just don't walk around with a Phillies hat much, though.
Well, things changed here too. And everybody had a Phillies hat, and the next day it was gone.
I hear you.
They get pissed off quick here.
Well, I mean, it was a great run. I mean, unfortunately, they didn't make it to the World Series, but it was a good year. So. We're going to wrap this puppy up. We try to keep it to about 30 minutes. And again,
one more second.
Yes, go ahead. I just remembered.
I think Stan has the list. You served in the Air Force, Jeff Stroud. And I think there were two other guys, one guy in California.
I have a list, but I don't know where it is. Forget where I put it. But there were a handful. Don
Pagliaro.
Pagliaro.
I think he was a 20-plus year Navy guy.
Okay.
That is impressive.
Yep. Yes.
I did talk to Fran Masciulli, as you did. He put a few years in
the Marines.
Yeah.
And that looked like fun. And you mentioned, I don't have the list in front of me. I forgot.
John Buttle. Yeah, I think there was but he was
Who's yeah, he was a Marine, I think.
Buttle.
I'm not sure.
I think you said, I think I recall you saying he was a Marine. The other person I want to mention, Stan, I don't know if you remember Ken Pepperisi. He didn't graduate with us, but he was in the Air Force. He lives up in New Hampshire. So a big shout out to all those people. And again, gratitude for their service.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Stan. Really appreciate this. We always pick out a song to end with. And, you know, we talked about the turbulent times that we grew up in. And I like this song from Marvin Gaye. What's Going On? 1971 is a great song. And the words say it all. They really do. Again, thank you. Take care, guys.
Brother, there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer. For only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Thank you.
picket flag and picket sight. Don't punish me with brutality. Come on, talk to me. You can see what's going on.